મોહેશ, હવે યાર યુટ્યુબ લાઈવ પર બી થઈ ગયું છે, તો હું
યા
આમ
યા
તને તને હોસ્ટ બનાવીને હું એક્ઝિટ લઉં છું.
નીરવભાઈ ને હોસ્ટ બનાવ.
ઓકે.
Of course, sir, we will wait for another 2 to 3 minutes, then we should start the program, I guess, as we have more than 135 registrations and we can see limited participants. So let's wait for 2 to 3 minutes. It will be benefit for all. Then we can start the program.
Yes, Nirobhai, because it's still the first part of the day and people are still reaching office. So probably, you know, the number would start coming in by 5-10 minutes more. So let's
sir,
wait
I think
for
we should
another
wait
5 minutes.
Or else, yes, we should
yeah,
wait,
we
for,
wait
5 minutes,
for 5 minutes. Yeah, Nirobhai, we wait for 5 minutes and then what we can do is we start with the formalities so that by 11:15 we can sharp start with sir's deliberation.
भाई मैं मौका देता है
वीडियो कर नहीं को बराबर है
वीडियो की के लिए
है
we should start now without
question. Exactly. I was on the same line.
Check the time of the participants who have joined on time.
Let's start with it.
Please, sir. Your opening remarks.
Good morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome on this rainy day. I know the rains of Section 148 notices are also as severe as the rains that have been in the last night. And today we decided that we would request none other than Advocate Sri Tushar Bhai Hemani Sahib to come up and deliver on the subject. I think me being from the indirect tax major, you know, but then again, as we all deal with Section 148 notices and stuff, it is going to be really important for us all to know the legality and the aspects of the. Can I request everyone to mute other than the speakers, please? Hira bhai, tamara kya thi awaaz chhe?
Na sir.
Okay. And with that opening remarks, I would now request Nirav bhai to start the session so that we can get more time of sir so that the proper deliverance on the subject can be done. Request Nirav bhai to take over.
Thank you, Monish bhai. Thank you so much. Tushar Hemani sir, as such, requires no introduction. He is a well-known face. Both at CA fraternity and with advocate faculty. So Tushar Hemani sir is a CA by qualified by profession. He is an advocate. He is a BCom honors. He is a speaker at various forums across India. He has successfully argued complex matters relating to both direct taxes and indirect taxes at Supreme Court, High Court, ITAT, NCLT, NCLAT, Appellate Tribunal under PBBT, PMLA, G-State, Commissioner Income Tax Appeals, and whatnot. And when we talk about 148 notices, and sir is himself taking a few matters, and we would love to know sir's experience and sir's what the current scenario is all about. So without wasting much of time and without coming in between with faculty and members, can I request sir to please take over the charge?
Thank you, Nirav bhai, for the kind words. Good morning, everyone. On this beautiful Saturday morning, we would be discussing sections which are not so beautiful, because those who are visited with the notices under reassessment, suddenly beauty goes out of their life. But as a professional, yes, when we discuss something academically, I think we all should feel happy that you know, we are furthering our knowledge. And believe me, every time, even when I take up any assignment, I decide to address a gathering, I also learn few things in the process. So it's a learning process for all of us. And government is making sure that we learn a lot by carrying out various amendments under various statutes. So we are, at least government makes sure that we are never lazy on our weekends also. Friends, what we propose to do is, it's 11:10 and we are supposed to finish by 1 o'clock. So for next 110 minutes, we'll be discussing broadly the old reassessment scheme, read with the new assessment scheme. In the first part, second part, the validity of the notices issued under the old scheme after 31st of March 2021 and before 30th of June 2021. And last around 10 minutes, we'll be devoting for the question answer sessions. So this is how we want to structure the whole program. Friends, with this little introduction, let me start. Yes. With the existing scheme of the Act. Before I take you to the new scheme, let us understand what is the existing scheme. Under the regular scheme, which is in existence up to 31st of March 2021, we have normal provisions under 147. For any reassessment up to a period of 6 years, reassessment can be done. The first step in that erstwhile scheme of the Act was to record the reasons. SSEs were never involved in that process of recording the reasons. It is the assessing officer who would record the reasons as a first step towards taking these remedial measures. In the reasons recorded, assessing officer would demonstrate that what are the objective facts based on which he has recorded his subjective satisfaction, to the effect that he has a reason to believe that some income which is chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. So this was in fact the first stage. The second stage is to issue notice under section 148. Once the notice is issued, the SSE would come to know that his assessment for a particular year is selected for reassessment proceedings. The SSE, in response to such notice, within a period of 30 days, would file the return of income. Simultaneously, would also ask for the reasons which are recorded for the purpose of reopening. Once the reasons are given to the SSEs, SSEs would go through those reasons and raise objections. Some are on facts, some are on the law. Those objections are thereafter dealt with by the assessing officer by passing a speaking order. Once that order is made available to the SSEs would decide whether this is a fit case for approaching the High Court under a writ jurisdiction for want of jurisdiction, etc. Or this is a case where they would like to appear before the assessing officer and contest the issue over there. As against that, we had a separate parallel process for search related cases. This also is, we are discussing scheme prior to 31st March 2021. If any search which has taken place up to 31st March 2021, the process is that automatically the search persons would be covered under section 153 capital A. The searcher and earlier 6 years are automatically covered under 153A. There is no requirement of recording any reasons and following the process which is laid down under 148. Straightway, notices under 153A would be issued. Those notices would be treated as if the notices are issued under 139. The SSEs would be called upon to file the returns of income. And once the returns are filed, the assessment would take place. The plain language of the section is not very indicative. However, large number of courts, including the Gujarat High Court, have taken the view that 153A is a search-related assessment, and therefore such assessments are restricted to the search material and the normal additions, which are otherwise can be made under the normal provisions of the Act, cannot be made while framing assessment under Section 153A. And so also 153C, which is a consequential action in the hands of a third party whose material is found during the course of search at any other SSEs. So these were two separate parallel schemes which were there in the Act, which was in force up to 31st March 2021. There is no special provision which is prescribed for survey-related cases. However, as per the internal guidelines of CBDT, the survey cases, the year of survey is always selected for the scrutiny assessment. However, there were no remedial or consequential actions insofar as survey-related cases are concerned. Based on the material which is found out from the premises of the person surveyed, probably consequential or remedial action could be taken in the hands of persons who are surveyed. But no separate procedure to speak of is prescribed. Now, come 1st April 2021, and the Parliament has come out with an altogether new Act. And that Act is now made applicable with effect from 1st April 2021. So any assessment which is initiated after 1st April 2021, the new law would apply. Mind you, this is a procedural law. The law is well settled that in case of a procedural law, because ultimately the initiation of reassessment proceeding is a procedural law. So all these procedural laws are held to be applicable even to the years which are though prior in period, point in time. However, when the procedure takes place, when the reassessment proceedings are initiated, the law which is there existing in the statute book is applicable. Therefore, though assessment year may pertain to a period prior to 31st March 2021, but if it is the reopening notice is issued after 1st April 2021, then the as per the normally accepted law, the existing law which is there in the statute book would apply. Now let's look at the new amendment which is now introduced into the statute book. I'll also be comparing the old Act versus new Act, but for the moment, let us go with the new Act. The opening is that if any income chargeable to tax in case of an SSE has escaped assessment for any assessment year, the assessing officer may, subject to the provisions of sections 148 to 153, assess or reassess such income. Pause here for a moment. So what is there that is coming out? Number one is that income chargeable to tax is the subject matter of controversy. Number two is such income which is chargeable to tax has escaped assessment for a particular assessment year. And third is the power which is given to the assessing officer to assess or reassess such income. Now, how this new Act is different as against the old Act? Let us compare the language of both the Acts. The first part is the old Act up to 31st March, and the later part is the new Act. So if we look at both these Acts side by side, what comes out is that the condition as regards escapement of income, which is chargeable to tax, is the same. So even in, under the old act, the act is that if the assessing officer has reason to believe that any income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment for any assessment year, the characteristics are that it is the assessing officer who must have reason to believe that income which is chargeable to tax has escaped assessment for any assessment year. As against that, now we have no belief of assessing officer. There is no reason to believe by any assessing officer. It is the fact that income which is chargeable to tax has escaped assessment for any assessment year. Now, what is the difference? Look, the difference fundamentally is the way in which the underlying escapement of income is required to be proved. The degree of proof is different in both this old language as well as the new language. In the old language, and this is in fact the prevalent language since time immemorial, probably from the beginning of 1961, the act came into force. The reason to believe has stayed. I'll be taking you to 1987-89 period where this aspect was sought to be changed. However, ultimately it was not done. Supreme Court has made some observations on those changes also. But then, predominantly, it is the assessing officer's belief as regards escapement of income, which is the foundation stone, which is the genesis, basis for the purpose of initiating the reassessment proceedings. Now, if you compare that with the new scheme, you would find that this belief has completely disappeared. And what is the significance of that? Look, if you want to understand the change, the shift, the way in which Parliament is now wanting to implement the new act, we have to understand the history. Because unless we understand the history, we can't digest the future, namely the changes which are made to that history and the reasons thereof. So therefore, it is very imperative to understand what is reason to believe. Because we have been using this phrase time and again, that reason to believe, reason to believe. Now, what is that reason to believe? Reason to believe was originally explained by the court, Supreme Court, way back in 1967 in the case of famous case of Berrien Chemicals. Under the Companies Act, the phrase came up for consideration before the Supreme Court, that what is the meaning of reason to believe? And Supreme Court said, let me read the bold portion, then I'll explain what does it mean. Undoubtedly, the word reason to believe relates to the process of entertaining an opinion, which is subjective in nature and is not liable to be scrutinized by the objective test of judicial scrutiny as in appeal. However, even the case where an action is founded on subjective satisfaction, the process of entertaining such belief is not bereft of any minimum safeguard against arbitrariness. So what does it mean? It means that, look, this is ultimately a subjective satisfaction of the authority. In our case, it is the assessing officer's subjective satisfaction, which is based on the objective criteria. Now, objective criteria are the information which is in possession of the assessing officer. Objective criteria are the reasons based on which this belief is founded. So the reasons are objective criteria. Those objective criteria are, mind you again, a play of words, are not subjective. They are objective. And therefore, the objective criteria have to be based on particular material, particular information, particular documents, which is in possession of the assessing officer. The courts, yes, in a given case, courts can examine whether based on those objective criteria, any logical, rational officer can reach to such a belief. And if the answer is yes, then the Supreme Court said that the matter ends there. You can't then test the sufficiency of the reason. In other words, there has to be a prima facie tentative material in possession of the assessing officer so as to reach to this subjective satisfaction. Subjective satisfaction cannot come out of thin air without there being any objective criteria. To that extent, yes, that decision is subject to scrutiny of the courts. However, the court would not then substitute the subjective satisfaction of the officer with its own satisfaction and say that we have a different rule for satisfying ourselves and therefore the assessing officer is not right when he reached to this satisfaction. Let us take an example so as to understand what is the meaning of this reason to believe and how does it work. Take a case of entry operator, because that is in fact the frequent reopenings that we are coming across. There is a search at some entry operator's premise and a diary is found out. From that diary or some Excel sheet in the computer, it has come out that they have given entries for penny stock to large number of SSCs. Now, based on this information, the SSC's name which has cropped up is the SSC who is your client. So therefore, the assessing officer gets this information from the investigation wing that during our search at a particular entry operator's premise, we found that he has given one entry to one SSC whose PAN is ABC. And we believe that there is a transaction between the entry operator and that SSC to the tune of, let's say, rupees 1 crore, and a capital gain is given to that SSC. The entry operator in his statement has said that he has given entries to large number of SSCs on exchange of cash. So on one hand, he received cash. On another hand, he has given the entry for capital gain. Based on this information, the investigation wing has prepared a small information note. And that note is sent to the assessing officer concerned, the person having who falls under the jurisdiction of a particular assessing officer. That assessing officer has now some objective material in the form of a letter. That letter gives an indication that yes, the SSC in question has entered into some transaction with one entry provider in the sum of rupees 1 crore for assessment year 15-16. The assessing officer has now objective material. Now he would like to record the satisfaction. Then what would he say? He would say that I have received an information from the investigation wing suggesting that the SSC in question has entered into one transaction of a penny stock amounting to around a rupees, sum of rupees 1 crore for assessment year 15-16. The entry operator has given a statement that he has accepted cash in lieu of capital gain. And therefore, these are sufficient material so as to reach to this belief that there is a case, prima facie, tentative case of escapement of income in the sum of rupees 1 crore. Because I believe that this sum of 1 crore, which is found credited in the books of the SSC, is nothing but an entry which is provided by this entry operator. And therefore, I have reason to believe that this income has escaped assessment. So far, so good. We know what is reason to believe, because reason to believe is based on objective criteria, namely the letter which is received from the investigation wing, along with probably, of course, the copy of the Excel sheet or the statement, copy of the statement, etc. All those supporting materials are also available with the assessing officer. So now the question would be that under such circumstances, whether any rational or logical person would have the same belief that some income has escaped assessment. We approach the Honorable High Court under the REIT jurisdiction, we would say that, sir, there is no material or material is not such that any reasonable person can reach to a reasonable belief that some income has escaped assessment. Court would then say that let us look at the material so as to find out whether a tentative prima facie belief is available to the SSC or not. And court would say that, yes, we find that there is a search, entry operator statement, the Excel sheet, the underlying transaction, the fact that SSC has shown this capital gain in his return of income, all these are prima facie sufficient material. Any reasonable person would reach to this belief that some income has escaped assessment. And therefore, though it's a subjective satisfaction, always open to judicial scrutiny, only to the extent that such satisfaction is recorded by relying on some objective test, on relying on some objective material, And any reasonable or a logical person would reach to such satisfaction based on such material which was placed before the assessing officer. What is not permissible is the sufficiency of reasons. I might argue before the court that, sir, this is not the material based on which you can make an addition, because I do not have any control over the Excel sheet maintained by such entry operator. He might write anybody's name. He might write anything. You can't make addition purely based on third party's Excel sheet or some diary maintained by him, which is under his exclusive possession. And I do not have any control what he writes in that Excel sheet or any diary which is maintained by him. And therefore, based only on this material, you can never make addition. And therefore, this is not a case where reopening can take place. Now, that is sufficiency of reason. Now, that is not permissible at this stage to be judged by the court. Because court would not say that this material, whether it is sufficient to make the addition or not. What the court would say is that this is a material based on which any reasonable person can have reason to believe. Therefore, there are reasons to believe in a particular hypothesis, and that hypothesis would be tested by the court only to that extent that whether such belief can arise, can be derived based on reading of that material. Now, come back to the present scenario. What is the present scenario? Now, reason to believe is not there. Therefore, subjective satisfaction criteria is not there. Therefore, the theory of prima facie tentative belief is not there. What is there now? What is there is that if any income chargeable to tax in the case of an SSC has escaped assessment. Now, in order to record this finding, kindly appreciate the play of the words, that in order to declare that some income has escaped assessment, one has to necessarily, and as a sine qua non, reach to the finding that that income was otherwise chargeable to tax. Otherwise, you can't assert, you can't then say that income has escaped assessment. So for the purpose of establishing that there is an escapement of income, one has to necessarily establish that there was this income which was otherwise taxable. Mind you, this is, we are not talking about the subjective satisfaction. We are not talking about the belief of a particular individual or an authority. We are here talking about the hard facts. And hard facts are that some income has escaped assessment which was otherwise chargeable to tax. Therefore, the assessing authority has to then record a finding that yes, there was this income. In the same example which I took, his belief is not, now today his belief is not material. He may believe anything. What is material is that whether this was the entry, 1 crore rupee, it was chargeable to tax, and whether it has escaped the assessment or no. And therefore, he has to then establish that this was an income which is certainly otherwise chargeable to tax in the hands of the SSC concern, and that has escaped the assessment. For that purpose, he has to establish the movement of cash, because ultimately the allegation against me is that I have given cash of rupees 1 crore to that entry provider, and that entry provider in turn has given me the entry of the capital gain, because otherwise I have earned that capital gain on the floor of the stock market. My argument is that this is a legit transaction executed on the floor of the stock market. And where is the proof that I have given cash so as to receive back this entry of rupees 1 crore by way of penny stock capital gain? And therefore, the factum that cash has exchanged hands from A to B is also required to be established. And the argument that merely because in somebody's books of account, which is diary or Excel sheet maintained by exclusively by that person over which I have admittedly no control, can that be used for the purpose of reaching to this conclusion that yes, there was this income which was taxable, and now we have realized that this has escaped the assessment. Therefore, this fundamental difference is that now the new law says that it is not the subjective satisfaction of the authority which is material, it is the hardcore fact which is required to be taken into consideration for the purpose of establishing that some income has escaped assessment. in order to understand what is the difference, one has to understand the significance of the word reason to believe. In fact, reason to believe is also more or less equated with in the opinion of the assessing officer. Again, both are subjective in its own way. One is there must be hardcore reasons to reach to a particular belief, whereas opinion is open-ended. I could be of a particular opinion under any circumstances. I need not have the objective criteria for that opinion. But nonetheless, both have been analyzed by the court. And ultimately, what the courts have held is that this is one area where the subjective process of satisfying an authority is material. Again, the courts have gone to the exchange of saying, and what follows is material. Kindly read with me the highlighted portion. That if it is shown that the circumstances do not exist or they are such that it is impossible for anyone to form an opinion therefrom, suggestive of the aforesaid things, the opinion is challengeable on the grounds of non-application of mind or perversity, or on the ground that it was formed on collateral grounds and was beyond the scope of the statute. So this is what I have indicated by giving an example. That yes, even under the old scheme, judicial scrutiny is permissible. However, the courts would only be examining whether there are sufficient grounds, there are sufficient material evidences in possession of the assessing officer so as to form this belief. And that belief ultimately is that of the assessing officer. And courts would not substitute its own belief with that of the assessing officer. So some amount of subjectivity, some amount of personal bias is bound to be there. And courts have recognized this. Now that is completely done away with under the new scheme. Now kindly try to appreciate the controversy from a slightly different angle. What I am trying to suggest before you has already been read and explained by Rajesh Jhaveri. The judgment, which is a landmark judgment and predominantly used against the SSCs on the ground that when it original assessment is done under 143.1, you can't go under 147 and the change of opinion argument is not available to you. And at the stage of 143.1, all that is required is only a very, very thin prima facie belief, and that is sufficient so as to give jurisdiction to the assessing officer. However, while explaining the concept in paragraph 16 of that judgment, what has come out, maybe unintentionally, because at that time this law was not at all there, but what has come out is something which is really unique and very, very useful for understanding the context in which I am trying to distinguish the language of old phrase versus the new phrase. Allow me to read this small paragraph and then I'll explain the significance of this. Section 147 authorizes and permits the assessing officer to assess or reassess income chargeable to tax if he has reason to believe that income for any assessment year has escaped assessment. The word reason in the phrase reason to believe would mean cause or justification. If the assessing officer has cause or justification to know or suppose that income has escaped assessment, it can be said to have a reason to believe that an income has escaped assessment. Now, kindly mark the words which follow this. The expression cannot be read to mean that the assessing officer should have finally ascertained the fact by legal evidence or conclusion. The function of the assessing officer is to administer the statute with solicitude for public exchequer with an inbuilt idea of fairness to taxpayers. As observed by the Supreme Court in Central Province Manganese so-and-so, for initiation of action under 147A, as the provision stood at the relevant time, fulfillment of two requisite conditions in that regard is essential. At that stage, the final outcome of the proceeding is not relevant. In other words, at the initiation stage, what is required is reason to believe, but not established fact of escapement of income. At that stage of issue of notice, the only question is whether there was relevant material on which a reasonable person could have formed a requisite belief. Whether the material would conclusively prove the escapement is not the concern at that stage. This is so because the formation of belief by the assessing officer is within the realm of subjective satisfaction. Now, this is precisely what I want to present before you, that this was the old scheme. Supreme Court has, in no uncertain terms, have clearly laid down that reason to believe can only be read in this manner, that at the time of recording the reasons, it's only the prima facie tentative satisfaction which is required, because that is the mandate of the statute. The final ascertained fact by legal evidence or conclusion is not at all required because of the expression reason to believe. Supreme Court is conscious that yes, we are interpreting the phrase reason to believe, and in that context court has said, in fact court has referred to the earlier two judgments of the Supreme Court wherein it is again categorically held that because of the language of the statute reason to believe, the final fact of income having escaped assessment is not required at this stage. Now, friends, kindly appreciate, reason to believe has disappeared. It is not there. And therefore, we have to attribute some significance to the Parliament's intention of doing away with this process of reason to believe. Because we all know that when the lawmakers, namely the Parliament, the legislature, either puts any words into the statute or deletes any word from the statute, there has to be a clear and underlying thought process behind such an action. Nothing is done without reasons. And therefore, we have to attribute some reason to the removal of the phrase reason to believe. And what is that attribution which we are trying to attribute? We are trying to attribute that particular aspect to the fact, if we look at the intention of the lawmakers by reading the notes on clauses, the reasons for introduction of all these provisions is that they want to make this process as tough as possible. The whole idea is that assessing officers should not be permitted to reopen concluded assessments at the drop of a hat, just like that, because they believe that there is some escapement of income. The intention is very clear that they want to make the process of reopening a very, very stringent process where there are checks and balances which are inbuilt into the statutory scheme, and therefore they have taken away the subjective satisfaction from the assessing authority. There is no other motive which can be attributed to the Parliament's action of removal of the phrase reason to believe. And that is manifested by this judgment of the Supreme Court, wherein the concept is categorically explained that if we remove reason to believe, what remains is the hardcore establishment of the fact that income has escaped assessment at the stage of reopening itself. And that is what is precisely done by the Parliament. Again, we come back to the old act and the new act. What we are now trying to analyze is that what is the proposition which has still survived even under the amended act, and what are the issues, what are the arguments which are no more available under the amended act. Escapement of income is a condition which we have already observed that which was prevalent under both the schemes, under the old scheme as well as under the new scheme. And therefore, that is a check which is already inbuilt into the scheme, both the schemes. What the court has said in the context of old law is equally applicable in the context of new law. This was a case where Honorable Gujarat High Court was concerned with the fact that there was this information with the assessing officer that the assessing question has taken some entry from entry provider in the form of purchases. Those purchases are held to be bogus purchases by the assessing authority based on the search at the premises of the entry provider. His statement, material which is found out, all those things indicated that he has given bogus bills to large number of parties. This SSE was one such SSE who took those bills and booked those purchases. The question before the court was that based on such entries, can the reopening take place? Court has said.
Just a minute. Request all participants joining in to be on mute so that the speaker is not disturbed. It's a request. Sorry, sir, for the interruption.
No problem. In fact, your turn, the participants' turn would come in some time, and probably then all of you can talk. For the time being, you have to bear me and listen to me only. What I was trying to point out was the fact that in this case, court prima facie held against the SSC that yes, there is a sufficient material so as to reach to this reason to believe, because we have found out some entries of your name in the entry provider's material. However, the alternate argument which was raised before the court was that this is a unit which is enjoying exemption under 10AA, and therefore its entire income is exempt. So therefore, assuming that the bogus purchases are booked, then what I have done is I have inflated my expenditure and resultantly reduced my profit. So even if assuming that this bogus purchases are held to be bogus, ultimately added to my income profit would go up, that increased profit would also be eligible under 10AA, because 10AA eligibility has not been doubted by the authorities at all. And therefore, in any case, where is the escapement of income? And therefore, if there is no escapement, how can there be a reassessment? Even if there is a strong reason to believe that there is this entry, which is subject matter of problem, but the prima facie or the basic condition that there is an escapement of income is not fulfilled. And in that context, Gujarat High Court said that yes, when this fundamental requirement of establishing that income as escape assessment fails, then you can't exercise the reopening powers. This principle would hold good even under the amended act. Is there any scope for fishing and rowing inquiries? In other words, I get some prima facie tentative information and based on that I reopen. Mind you, now the tests are more stringent. Reason to believe won't work. It has to be the hardcore establishment of fact that income having escape assessment. Nonetheless, in a given case, assessing authority come out by saying that we need to examine, we need to investigate all these transactions so as to establish the escapement of income, whether such fishing rowing inquiries are permissible and even under the amended act. The answer is again, is more empathetic no, because as against, we have already seen reason to believe, now there is an escapement which is required to be established, and therefore fishing rowing inquiries would never establish the fact that income is escape assessment, and therefore this principle would also hold good. Again, this cause and effect relationship between the reasons and income escaping assessment is required to be established or no. This was one case where, in order to understand this proposition, because it is slightly confusing reading from the heading, that what does this indicate? It indicates that the reasons which are recorded and ultimately the conclusion which is derived from such reasons need to have some live and close nexus. So by reading of the reasons, one must reach to a prima facie tentative conclusion that there is an escapement of income. So reasons are the cause and effect must be the escapement of income. If these two things, namely the cause and effect, are completely unconnected, then the fact of income having escaped assessment cannot be established. And in particular situation, such was not the case. Kindly look at the reasons. What was the reasons which were recorded in this judgment? Reasons were that it is seen that the SSC has transferred 5,30,000 shares during the year under consideration, whose market value on the date of transfer was 7.63 crore, without consideration to Messrs. So-and-so by way of transfer deed dated 26-2-2010. In view of the above fact, I have reason to believe that income has escaped assessment. Now, where is that reason to believe? Where is that fact that some income has escaped assessment? We do not know the relationship between the SSC and this transferee. We do not know whether this transaction at all can be taxed as a capital gain. We do not know what was the cost of acquisition in the hands of the transferor. It could be the same cost of acquisition. We do not know whether it is a holding subsidiary transaction. Therefore, there are large number of things which are not coming out categorically. In absence of that, no logical or rational person can reach to this conclusion that there is an escapement of income by reading these three lines. And therefore, court said that there is no cause and effect relationship between the reasons and escapement of income. And therefore, such vague reasons are not a ground for the purpose of reopening. Now, this proposition would hold good again with more emphasis under the new scheme also, because there has to be some material between the order which would be passed under 148A and ultimate action of reopening. What we have lost, look, what we have lost is the first proviso to 147. In fact, this was one proviso which was there again since the inception of the Act. Even under the old Act, this proviso was there, maybe in a slightly different avatar. But then this was always there in the statute book. And what was that proviso? Proviso was that if at all reopening is happening, in case of a concluded assessment, namely under 143.3 assessment, then that too beyond a period of 4 years, then the such reopening can take place only when the revenue establishes that there was a failure on the part of the assessee to disclose fully and truly all material facts necessary for his assessment. In other words, the reasons which were to be recorded for the purpose of reopening a concluded assessment beyond a period of 4 years, and when the original assessment is done under the scrutiny assessment, the failure has to be attributed to the assessees. If there was no failure on the part of the assessees, the revenue were not allowed to reopen such cases, because the underlying principle is that someone has already suffered an assessment. During the course of the assessment, revenue is expected to act in a diligent manner. They are expected to verify, check each and every aspect of that assessment. And therefore, when the opportunity was available to the revenue authorities, if they choose not to carry out the proper investigation, then that failure on the part of the revenue in properly checking, analyzing, and examining cannot be a ground for reopening so as to benefit them only. So revenue's mistake cannot be used for the purpose of benefiting the revenue itself. So nobody should be benefited from their own mistakes. It's a well-known legal phrase. And therefore, applying that, the law says that it's only when the assessee fails in its duty to disclose fully and truly all material facts, the revenue can assume jurisdiction. And therefore, this was one more stringent check on the powers of the revenue authorities to reopen. Now, this proviso is gone. So therefore, even if the reopening is beyond a period of up to three years or between 3 to 10 years, now there are only two slabs. Even if there is no failure on my part, if revenue feels that yes, there is an escapement of income, the concluded assessment can be reopened, and this benefit of this proviso is not available to the assessee. So also the third proviso is now again gone. Third proviso was to the effect that any assessment which is subject matter of a further appeal, reference, or revision, and the issues which are taken or which are subject matter of such appeals can never be reopened by the assessing authority. Let's say 10A is an issue. The quantification, etc., of 10A was a subject matter of controversy during the assessment proceedings. Assessing officer did not allow the exemption under 10A on the trading profit, because you have considered those profits as deemed export by supplying material to your another EOU. So he has disallowed 10A deduction to that extent. However, he has granted you 10A deduction on other income. Now, assessing officer wants to reopen to tax that other income and deny you deduction under 10A. Original disallowance of 10A vis-a-vis that trading profit is already a subject matter of CIT appeal, because your appeal is pending, and quantification issue as regards 10A is a subject matter of appeal. Maybe from a different angle, maybe from a different facet. But nonetheless, the issue of 10A is pending before the appellate authority. Courts have time and again taken the view that under such a circumstances, firstly, on the ground of reading of the third proviso, this action is not justified. And secondly, on the principle of merger, such an action is not permissible, because CIT appeals has all the power to enhance also. And enhancement could be by way of denying the deduction under section 10A on other income. And therefore, this proviso was very useful so as to avoid reopening on the matters which are subject matter of appeal. Now, this proviso is also taken. Therefore, in other words, even if something is a subject matter of appeal, pending that appeal, if revenue authorities can establish that there is an escapement of income, they can reopen. There is one interesting development which has taken place and which probably would be having far-reaching consequences. If you look at the old act would say that assessing officer has reason to believe some income has escaped assessment. Then the assessing, he may, now kindly read from third line onwards, he may subject to the provisions of section 148 to 153, assess or reassess such income and also any such other income chargeable to tax which has escaped assessment and which comes to his notice subsequently in the course of the proceedings under this act, under this section, sorry. Therefore, what the law says is that once a reopening is validly reopened, then the subject matters of reasons can be assessed or reassessed such income, and now that and has to be read with the remaining part. Therefore, it is not or, it is and. And therefore, and such some other income which is chargeable to tax and which comes to his notice during the course of the reassessment proceedings. So the moment he assesses or reassesses you on the income, which is a subject matter of reasons recorded, he has license to add anything, whatever comes to his light during the course of the reassessment proceedings. Now that phrase is missing. Kindly look at the existing act. Existing is the new act. That if any income chargeable to tax in the case of an SSC has escaped assessment for any assessment year, the assessing officer may subject to the provisions of 148 to 53 assess or reassess such income or recompute the loss or the depreciation allowance or any other allowance, so and so, so and so, so and so. Therefore, that condition that such income and any such income, so and which was to be read with this phrase and was making it compulsory to add the subject matter of reasons as a sine qua non for the purpose of making any other addition is now taken away. The effect is that now if the assessing officer assesses you, if he reopens a particular assessment and if he wants to assess you for something which is not subject matter of grounds of reopening but some other completely unconnected matter, he can do so and he can choose not to make any addition insofar as the grounds of reopening are concerned. And that also appears to be permissible under this amended existing law. Kindly see the impact of explanation which is now appended to 147. On the first page, when we were reading the existing act, we skipped the explanation, reading the second part. Now, this explanation I have reproduced over here. Existing act under 147, the explanation is there. As against that, we had an explanation, explanation 3 under 147 of the act. Now, both these explanations are bearing the grammatical variation, have the same meaning. And what is that meaning? Original explanation, old act, was that for the purpose of assessment or reassessment under this section, the assessing officer may assess or reassess the income in respect of any issue which has escaped assessment and such issue comes to his notice subsequently in the course of the proceedings under this section, notwithstanding that reasons for such issues have not been included in the reasons recorded under subsection 2 of 148. And now what is the amended explanation to 147? This is the only explanation to 147. That for the purpose of assessment or reassessment or recomputation under this section, the assessing officer may reassess or reassess the income in respect of any issue. Kindly mark, assess or reassess the income in respect of any issue which has escaped assessment and such issue comes to his notice subsequently in the course of the proceedings under this section, irrespective of the fact that the provisions of section 148A have not been complied with. So in other words, assessing officer may assess or reassess income in respect of any issue. So therefore, any issue means issues which are subject matter of 148A proceedings or issues which are not subject matter of 148A proceedings. So anything can be added. So therefore, both these explanations are pari materia. Explanation 3 under the old act and explanation under the existing act. Both are pari materia. There is no material change. And therefore, we go back again to the variation in the language of the old act as compared to new act, and the inescapable conclusion is that under the old act, this was not permissible unless any assessment of any other income was not permissible unless you first assess or reassess the subject matter of reopening, namely the item which is flowing from the reasons recorded. Now, no such preconditions or no such qualifications are available under the amended act. And therefore, kindly appreciate from a slightly different angle, your assessment might get reopened on the ground that you have followed a completely impermissible method of valuing your closing stock. And therefore, we want to add the difference in your closing stock. And to that extent, we believe, of course, mind my word, belief word is not there. Therefore, to that extent, there is an escapement of income. And therefore, we reopen. However, during the course of the assessment proceedings, they find out that no, this is the method which is consistently followed, and this method would not give rise to any escapement of income. They may drop that and assess you for some completely unconnected other issues, which may come to their knowledge while carrying out the reassessment proceedings. And that is perfectly permissible under the amended act. And this is such a scary situation, because reassessment can take place on any issue, any legally debatable issue, any issue where inquiries of facts can take courts to a great depth into the factual aspect of the matter, and courts would be thereafter finding extremely difficult to look into those aspects. And they say that no, you face the assessing authority, go for reopening and raise all these issues in the reassessment proceedings. Reassessment can be initiated on any ground, and that ground can be abandoned at a later stage. Is a very scary situation in the present day scenario. All those judgments, including the judgment of Gujarat High Court directly on the issue, that the jurisdiction can only be assumed if the subject matter of reopening is added. If assessment order is ultimately framed without making any addition on the grounds on which reopening is sought to be carried out, is not permissible. All these judgments, in my humble opinion, would not now be useful because there is a change in the language. I indicated earlier that the concept of change of opinion, and so also the history as regards the reason to believe or assessing officer's opinion, was a subject matter of judicial scrutiny, and that is in the famous judgment of Calvinator of India Limited. This was one judgment wherein the concept of change of opinion is explained by the court, and this is one proposition which would hold good even under the amended law, because change of opinion is an inbuilt counterbalance which is there in the statute itself, so as not to give jurisdiction to the assessing officer merely because there is a change of opinion or he wants to review his own work, maybe carried out by his predecessor, and he might feel that he was left out in the original party. He wants his share, but nonetheless, that would not be a ground for the purpose of carrying out the reassessment proceedings, because that would amount to change of opinion. If one looks at the history, 1987, the Direct Tax Laws Amendment Act 1987 had also made similar proposition where the lawmakers wanted to do away with the concept phrase reason to believe, and they replaced that reason to believe, that phrase, by the phrase assessing officer's opinion. Namely, that if the AO for the reasons to be recorded by him in writing is of the opinion that any income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. Therefore, the attempt was made in 1987 to replace the phrase reason to believe with assessing officer's opinion. However, during those days, representations were considered quite positively, and the representations made by large number of trade bodies as well as the professional body indicated that, sir, reason to believe has a greater control over the actions of the assessing authority, as against that, opinion of the assessing officer is a very loose satisfaction, and that would give great freedom to the assessing authorities without there being any counter check on his actions. And therefore, kindly do not replace the phrase reason to believe with in the opinion of the assessing officer. And ultimately, Parliament Committee recommended, and the law was once again changed. In fact, the opinion part never came into effect. Before that could be made effective, the parliament joint committee parliamentary committee has accepted the recommendations and turned back to the phrase reason to believe. However, even under the reason to believe, the question before the court was that whether the concept of change of opinion would hold water or no. And this is what the court has said, that even under the amended act, there is always absence of power to review. Court has said that there is, when we look at the scheme of the Income Tax Act, we realize that there is no power of review given to any authority. There are only remedial actions which are available. To the limited extent to which review powers are available, they flow from 154, and that is only rectification power, that too on the mistakes which are apparent from record itself. There is no power of review. And if there is no power of review, the same power which cannot be directly applied, cannot be indirectly be allowed to be applied in case where there is a reassessment, which is in the nothing but a power of exercising the review exercise, and that limited power of review is also not available. And therefore, this is nothing but a change of opinion, which is an inbuilt test to check the abuse of power by the assessing authority. And therefore, this change of opinion, though you would not find in the language of any of the earlier act also, that if change of opinion is there, you can't reopen. However, courts have time and again said that if at all a particular issue is gone into threadbare, then such an exercise of change of power, change of opinion is not permissible. So under the amended act, under the existing act, can we say that change of opinion is still a good argument? My opinion is that yes, change of opinion is a good argument. Supposing in a given case, a particular issue is raised during the course of the assessment proceedings, whether you are eligible for claim of 10AA or no has been raised. Notice is issued that justify the claim which you have made in your return of income. You give submissions after submissions, submit the audit report, submit your submissions on various legal as well as factual aspects of the matter. Now, within a period of 3 years, assessing officer wants to now reopen and argue that yes, now we have reached to a conclusion that there is an escapement of income because you claim 10AA deduction on a completely impermissible grounds. Then one can straightway argue that, sir, this aspect was checked originally, so causes etc. were issued and my replies are available on record, and therefore this is nothing but change of opinion. And that argument is still valid even under the amended act. A side issue, which again is holding good even under the present day context, under the new act, is in the given example, there were so-called notices issued to the SSC by the assessing authority as regards eligibility to claim 10AA deduction. Replies were available on record. However, there is no specific discussion in the body of the assessment order because assessing authority accepted the claim of the SSC. And all of us are aware that the claims which are positively accepted, which are not disturbed by the assessing authority, we usually do not find the discussion on those issues which are accepted by the assessing authority. And therefore, the question would be that under such a circumstances, can you argue change of opinion? Because in the body of the assessment order, there is no opinion which is there. I do not find any opinion getting reflected into the body of the assessment order. And then can it be argued still that there is a change of opinion? Because where is the original opinion in the first place? Gujarat High Court, in all these judgments, two judgments of Gujarat High Court, thereafter also there are quite a few judgments now available on record, that such an exercise is not permissible because there is a concept known as dimmed opinion, and that dimmed opinion is formed the day on which he issued the so-called notices and he entertained the replies thereof. The moment those material is available with the assessing officer, then it is a conscious call on the part of the assessing authority in not making any addition on that, and therefore it will be considered as a dimmed opinion. Now we come to 148 capital A. What is the change in the system? Look, what was the existing system? I have briefly indicated the existing system, which was laid down by GKM Dryshaw at the while opening the presentation, that there is this process whereby reasons are recorded, notice issued, written files, objections raised, and they are disposed of. Gujarat High Court in the later judgment of Sahakari Khand Udyog 370 ITR also laid down time limits for these actions. So within how much time notice is required to be complied with and reasons are to be supplied, and all those time limits are also specified. So law in this respect is well settled. Now, what is the change? The first major change, again, mind you, this is one change which is going to have long lasting repercussions in the days to come. 148 subsection 2 said that before issuing the notice under this section, the reasons are required to be recorded in writing. So the first part, for the purpose of assuming the jurisdiction, the assessing authority has to first record the reasons. As I indicated earlier, that recording of the reason is, though subject to judicial test, however, it is an administrative process. And therefore, SSA's presence is not required when the reasons are recorded. And therefore, reasons are recorded broadly on two counts. One, the material which is available on the assessment file. And two, the material which comes into the possession of the authorities post-assessment. Based on these two issues, the reasons are recorded. And those are the reasons from which the jurisdiction to issue notice under 148 flows. And therefore, well before the notice is issued, the reasons are frozen. They are recorded in writing and it cannot be added, altered, amended, or modified in any manner whatsoever. Reopening either survives or it fails based on the reasons which are already recorded. They are already on the file of the assessing authority when he issues the notice under 158. Now, this was the position. And courts have time and again come out very strongly that you can't improve the reasons. You can't thereafter modify the reasons because you come to know about certain other facts, certain other arguments so as to improve your reasons. That is not permissible. Once you record the reason, you become functus officio. You can't thereafter control the reasons. The reasons, they are now beyond your control. It is only the court who can decide whether such reasons can give jurisdiction to issue 148 notice or no. No amendment alteration is permissible. This was the position. Now kindly compare that with the amended act. Amended act under 148A is a very complex piece of statute. Let us read the clauses one by one and try to understand the significance of each clause. The assessing officer shall, kindly mark the word, shall, before issuing any notice under section 148. So before issuance of notice under 148, assessing officer shall, what does he do? A, conduct any inquiry if required. Now that again is a discretion of the assessing authority. He might conduct an inquiry, he may not conduct any inquiry before step B. So conduct any inquiry if required, with the prior approval of the specified authority. Kindly mark the word prior approval. So even before he can choose to conduct an inquiry, he can do so only after taking prior approval of the higher authority. Specified authority is defined under 151, commissioner or principal chief commissioner. With respect to the information which suggests that the income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. So therefore, two things are being talked about. That he cannot conduct any inquiry. He can't say that I feel like conducting some inquiry, therefore let me conduct some inquiry. No, he can conduct inquiry only with respect to information. Now, definition of information is there under the statute. I'll take you there shortly from now. With respect to information, and that information again must suggest. Now, suggest is not defined, but suggest is has a grammatical general meaning. What that information must suggest? That income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. So three things. Some information must suggest that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. One, these three things exist. Then if he so desires, with the prior approval of the assessing authority, he can conduct an inquiry. So conduct an inquiry is he can issue notices under 133.6, he can collect information under 131, or he can, in a given case, collect the information from other assessing authorities or investigation wing. We do not know what is the scope of this inquiry at this stage. Clause B, provide an opportunity of being heard to the SSC, again with the prior approval of the authority. So therefore, once the inquiry is conducted, then the second stage, provide an opportunity of being heard. That too, after taking prior approval, by serving upon the SSC a show cause notice within such time is maybe specified in the notice, being not less than 7 days, but not exceeding 30 days from the date on which such notice is issued or such time is maybe extended by him on the basis of an application on this behalf as to why a notice under 148 should not be issued on the basis of the information which suggests that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment in his case for the relevant assessment year and the result of inquiry conducted, if any, as per clause A. So this is the stage where information coming into possession of the assessing authority, which suggests that there is some escapement of income, there is some inquiry conducted by him, assessing authority prepares a prima facie reason to reopen. Look, under the old provision, that prima facie reason to reopen was the final reasons to reopen. Here, it is only the tentative reasons to reopen. What does he do? Once he has that tentative reasons to reopen, once he have that particular information, which is then converted by carrying out inquiries, by carrying out various investigations, is converted into a prima facie tentative belief in the form of a reason to believe, which is equivalent to our final reason to believe. He calls upon the SSC to justify why reopening cannot take place. And this is where there is a fundamental difference between the two sets of schemes of the Act. Earlier, it was the final reasons to reopen, and therefore all my objections would go to demolish the reasons which are already available on record. Here, all my objections would only strengthen, because there he has one more step, and that one more step is to improve on the reasons based on my objections to come out with a final order under 148A. And therefore, whatever objections which I take before the authorities would go in improving the reasons which are recorded. And now the reasons are going to be recorded in my presence. Therefore, any factual inaccuracies, any legal incongruity, anything which was hitherto used by the SSCs for the purpose of demolishing the reasons before the High Court would happen before the assessing authority. And assessing authority would come out with the revised, improved version of the reasons so as to justify his action of reopening. At this stage, one more material aspect is opportunity of being heard is provided under 148 capital A. Whether a personal hearing at this stage is contemplated or no, not coming out very categorically, because even under 151 and 151 capital A, there is no mention of any personal hearing. However, going by the 144 A and B schemes under the faceless assessment schemes, the concept of personal hearing is very much there. And therefore, while raising objections under 148 capital A, if you believe that you want personal hearing, kindly always write as a separate paragraph that in a given case, if you are not agreeable with my proposal of dropping the reassessment proceedings, kindly grant me an opportunity of personal hearing that may come to your rescue at some later stage. So therefore, always, whenever you are replying to 148A proceedings and raising objections, ask for the personal hearing if possible. If you believe that issue can be decided without a personal hearing, probably you can drop that idea. But then what is material for our purposes is that here the assessing authority has power to grant you extension also. Because if you feel that, no, I need more time under 148A to reply to your notices, kindly grant me time beyond 7 to 30 days period. But remember one thing, that whatever time that he grants over here would be added to the limitation which is prescribed. I'll take you to the appropriate place where the order is required to be passed, and that extended time limit is available to him for the purpose of issuing the final 148A notice. So adjournment that you ask for here would extend your limitation period. Clause C, consider the reply of the SSE furnace, if any, in response to the SOCO's notice referred to in B. So we have already covered this, that there he will pass a reasoned, a well-balanced order under 148A. Now, that order would be passed under clause D. What is that order? Decide on the basis of material available on record, including the reply of the SSC, whether or not it is a fit case to issue a notice under 148 by passing an order with the prior approval of the specified authority within 1 month from the end of the month in which reply referred to in clause C is received by him, or where no such reply is furnished within 1 month from the end of the month in which time or extended time allowed to furnish a reply as per clause B expires, provided that the provisions of this section shall not apply in a case where, we'll come to this proviso little later. What does this clause B indicate then? Finally, he would pass. Again, look at the words, appreciate the words which are explicit in nature. Material available on record, including the reply of the SEC. So my reply, wherein I raise all kinds of objections, factual, legal, would be used against me for the purpose of passing a final order under 148 capital A. Mind you, this is a process which is now statutory process. And therefore, if you do not raise a particular objection over here, in all probability, the court, if you happen to challenge this reopening before the court of law, before the constitutional court, namely Supreme Court or High Courts, courts might not allow you to raise those objections before it for the first time. Courts might say that, sir, you had an opportunity to raise all these contentions before the assessing authority. Under clause B, you could have raised these objections. Now, having failed in doing that, we would not like you to raise those grievances over here. And I'm sure that whatever grievances that you raise before the authorities, whether it is factual or legal, would be taken care of under clause D. Mind you, the fundamental difference between arguing an appeal on merits and challenging a writ provision before the High Court is the degree of proof which is required. In an appeal, the proof or the degree is to the hilt, is to the fullest. And therefore, any doubt, any reasonable doubt, would always be held in favor of the assessee. Because you can't tax something where there is a doubt. And if at all any doubt is there, the view must be in favor of the assessee. However, as against that, when we challenge the reopening process, here the courts are not concerned with the merits. Courts are only concerned with the jurisdiction to reopen. And while deciding the jurisdiction, what is required is only the smallest amount of jurisdiction, only the part jurisdiction, only a very tentative prima facie jurisdiction. And even if there is a reasonable amount of doubt, the court would take a view that you undergo the assessment proceedings. And if at all any doubt still remains after the assessment is framed, there is no question of making any addition in your hand. However, at this stage, when there is a reasonable amount of doubt, we would not like to prevent the revenue authorities from carrying out the investigation, from framing the assessment order. And therefore, this degree of proof will hurt us when we actually challenge 148A in times to come. Because this order is going to be a reasoned order, is going to be an order after considering all objections, both on facts as well as on law. And therefore, it will be extremely difficult to come out of this, I would say, revised and the improved reasons which are recorded by the authority. Now, 148 capital A process is not applicable to what? It is not applicable to search assessment. Obviously, in case of a search assessment, there is no question of going through the process of 148A. However, because they are automatic reopening, the moment there is a search, there is an automatic reopening. We'll see that under 148 proper, not under 148A. However, at this stage, in order to complete the chronology, 148A process, namely giving the prima facie material, calling for the objections and then dealing with the objection process, is not there insofar as search proceedings are concerned. Again, automatic reopening is only for 3 years. In case of search, the reopening can take place even for periods which are prior to 3 years. And when the reopening takes place for periods which is prior to 3 years, 148 capital A process is mandatory or no. My view is that under even for a period which is prior to 148A, prior to 3 years, 148A process is not required under search assessment. It is automatic. Again, this is clause B is search in case of a third party analogous to 153C proceedings. There also 148A capital A process is not required. Third is again, one more facet of 153C. Earlier part was dealing with money, bullion, jewelry or other valuable article. Later part, clause C, deals with books of accounts and documents. Again, the degree of proof is different. Earlier it is belongs to, later part it pertains to or relates to, same as 153C. Mark the absence of survey proceedings over here. For survey proceedings, 148 capital A process is required. Though reopening is automatic insofar as survey is concerned. Again, I'll take you there shortly from now. However, 148A process is required. In other words, in case of survey, for any reassessment of a period up to 3 years from the date of survey, these 3 years, assessing officer has to follow the process of 148 capital A. Namely, he has to prima facie records, record the satisfaction, give it to the SSC, call for objections, deal with those objections, pass the final order. The survey is not automatic. Clause D, yes, that would take me to 148 per se. 148 talks about issuance of notice. Once the assessing authority passes an order under 148 capital A, he is now ready to issue the notice under 148. So what does the section say? Section says that before making the assessment, reassessment, recomputation under section 147 and subject to the provisions of section 148 capital A. So kindly mark the word subject to the provisions of section 148 capital A. So unless there is an order which is suggestive of the fact that yes, this is a fit case where some income has escaped assessment based on some information and therefore 148 is required. Unless such an order is there, no 148 notice can be issued. The assessing officer shall serve on the SSC a notice along with the copy of the order passed, if required, under clause D of section 148A. Now, what is the significance of if required? If required, does it suggest that only in selected few cases, the assessing officer will give you the order under 148A? Or is it that the assessing authority has to shall serve on the SSC along with the notice and order passed under 148 capital A? Sorry. Apparently, the answer is that if required, that phrase goes with the search cases where 148A requirement is not there. We had already seen that in case of search, in case of a search in the case of the SSC, in case of a search at a third party, there are three situations where 148A process is not contemplated under the scheme of the Act. And if required, the phrase goes with those three situations contemplated. And therefore, if required is not to be read when there is an order under 148A. The moment there is an order under 148A, the assessing officer shall serve such an order on the SSC so as to assume jurisdiction under 148A. There is no discretion which is available in my humble opinion. Otherwise, the whole process of 148A becomes infructuous. It becomes useless because 148A process is effectively the process of recording of reasons. And courts have time and again, even under the old provisions, prior to GK and Rao Shah, courts have taken the view that SSC has a right to reasons recorded. Unless the reasons are supplied, the SSC cannot be expected to participate in the reassessment proceedings. And therefore, 148A cannot now be interpreted so as to give discretion to the assessing authority that in some cases you may serve 148A, in some cases you may not serve 148A. if required, is only vis-a-vis those search cases. Then the process, 148A notice process is there. You have to file the return within some time and then go on with the process. What is material is the proviso. Kind of look at the proviso. Provided that no notice under this section shall be issued unless there is information with the assessing officer which suggests that the income chargeable to tax as ASCAP assessment in case of the assessee for the relevant assessment year and the assessing officer has obtained prior approval of specified authority to issue such notice. Now, kindly appreciate this prior approval for issuance of notice is common. It is for all kinds of assessees. But it can only be exercised if twin conditions are fulfilled. And the proviso is very, very unequivocal, very categorical, that no notice under this section shall be issued unless what? One, there is an information. What is information? Immediately it is clarified. And secondly, that information must suggest that there is some income chargeable to tax which has ASCAP assessment. So twin condition, and then you can issue notice under 148. Now, what is the information? In fact, information was available under the old scheme prior to 1989. There was 147 split into two parts. And the information was one of the criteria for the purpose of reopening. And in that context, information is already interpreted. We'll see the actual interpretation of information compared to this interpretation of the Supreme Court. A. Raman and Company, it's a landmark judgment on so far as interpretation of information is concerned. The expression information in the context of in which it occurs must, in our judgment, mean instruction or knowledge derived from an external source concerning facts or particulars or as to law relating to a matter bearing on the assessment. In other words, it could be information could be in the form of an instruction or in the form of a knowledge which is coming into possession of the assessing authority from some external source and concerning some facts or particulars which has some bearing on framing of the assessment. This is the general meaning of information, and in fact it holds good even today also, that what is the information? Not all kinds of information. Information must be in the form of some material, some knowledge, some instruction, which has a bearing on the computation of total income. This, again, as per the Supreme Court, information is the starting point. And this starting point can set in motion the process of reassessment. Supreme Court's observation is that information in the possession, in his possession, that income chargeable to tax has ASCAP assessment, furnishes a starting point for assessing or reassessing the income. So it is a starting point. Here also, we know now under the amended act also, the proviso says that must be an information. Information must suggest that income has ASCAP assessment. Therefore, the information coming into possession of the assessing authority is the starting point. Now, Supreme Court said that information both in the field of law as well as in the field of facts, both information are relevant for the purpose of Income Tax Act reopening process. And therefore, merely because some information is in the form of law is not precluded. However, later on, Supreme Court clarified I'll take you to that judgment shortly from now. In the Express newspaper judgment, Supreme Court has clarified that in case if at the original stage some legal provisions have already been analyzed by the assessing authority, merely because audit party has a different call on that particular interpretation, there is no question of then treating the audit party information as an information in the eye of law. In fact, in the present existing scheme, one can argue that if original stage the law is analyzed by the assessing authority, it is nothing but change of opinion. And therefore, even if there is an information which might suggest in a given case that there is an escapement of income, however, that situation would not pass the test of change of opinion, and therefore reopening must fail. Now, information dictionary meaning we have discussed. In fact, there is nothing more to read or interpret over here. Information has must have a live and direct nexus between the escapement of income. That is the phrase which one has to remember, that information does not mean any information. That information must have a direct live nexus with the escapement of income. And it is only such information which can be used for the purpose of reopening. Now, explanation 1 to 148 talks about what is the information. For the purpose of this section, in sections 148A, the information with the assessing officer which suggests that the income chargeable to tax has escape assessment means. Kindly mark the word means. It does not say includes. If it had it said includes, probably we would have then taken into consideration the normal meaning plus the inclusive meaning. Here, the legislature seems to be suggesting that it must mean the following, and therefore it is now assigning a restrictive meaning to the term information. Therefore, any other meaning which is beyond these two clauses is not contemplated by the lawmakers. They don't say that information in its general form includes whatever is ABC and also includes the following. No, it does not say so. It says that information means. Therefore, this is a restrictive definition, and therefore the restrictive meaning to the term information is required to be assigned. Now, what is that restrictive meaning? One, any information flagged in the case of the SSC for the relevant assessment year in accordance with the risk management strategy formulated by the board from time to time. So, first part of the information is risk management strategy, which is formulated by board from time to time. We do not know what is the risk management strategy, what is going to be formulated by board from time to time. But then two things are very, very categorical. One is that such information would be flagged. Namely, it will be identified by the board. That is one part. And second part, the risk management strategy is a dynamic concept. It is going to be formulated from time to time. So today we have a risk management strategy which would include A to B, only A and B, two things. Tomorrow we might have a risk management strategy which might include letters A to S, and thereafter we might come back to A to F. So we do not know what are the criteria for risk management flagging system, whether it is based on the information received from the investigation wing, it is based on the pool of specified SSEs, whether it is based on the information received from SEBI, namely identifying the penny stocks, shares, the names of those stocks, or it is based on the cash transactions that you have carried out, or it is based on the information reports which are generated by large number of entities which are defined under 285AB. We do not know today what is going to be the risk management strategy. But what frightens me is the fact that this is going to be a dynamic risk management strategy. It will undergo changes on the need basis, whether it is going to be a universal strategy or it is a strategy to get hold of few SSEs. We do not know. And therefore, at this stage, we do not know anything about risk management strategy. We would go with the flow that risk management strategy is something which is going to be defined by the CBDT, and it is going to cover large number of situations. Part two, namely any final objections raised by the Comptroller and Auditor General of India to the effect that the assessment in the case of the SSS for the relevant assessment year has not been made in accordance with the provisions of this Act. So now CNAG audit objection is made part of the information. Mark the word final objections. Therefore, the intermediary correspondence exchange between the CNAG and the assessing officer cannot be treated as an information. It is only the final objection raised by the CNAG, which is going to be treated as an information. And it is now given a statutory color. Hitherto, CNAG audit was always for the remedial actions, and assessing authorities were time and again acting based on this information which is available with it. Now it is given a statutory color, and therefore officially the authorities can take get hold of an information in the form of audit objection. Risk management 285 BA, large number of data would be gathered. That data would be mined, processed by the CBDT, and they might come out with certain flagging system whereby SSAs at large or some group of specified SSAs would be covered, and against them remedial actions would be taken. The judgment which I indicated just now was with respect to Indian Newspaper and Agency, that is 119 ITR 996. There this concept that audit party merely having a different take on the interpretation of the provisions would not give them the necessary jurisdiction. However, this was prior to definition of information. After definition of information, probably matter will have to be argued and tested on the judicial platform. Audit objection is a well-known concept, and we can skip the judgment for the time being. Again, explanation 2 to 148. Now, 148.2 says, what does it say? That for the purpose of this, where clause 1 deals with search. For the purpose of explanation 2, search which is initiated after 1st of April 2021, that is part 1. Part 2 is a survey which is conducted after 1st day of April 2021. Part 3, first part of 153C, existing search at a third party and money, bullion, jewelry, other valuable article belong to the SSA is found after 1st April 2021. And second part, namely clause 4, deals with the documents and books of accounts which is pertain to or information contained therein relate to the SSA. The assessing officer shall be deemed to have information which suggests that the income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment in case of the SSA for the 3 assessment years immediately preceding the assessment year relevant to the previous year in which the search is initiated, or books of accounts, other documents, or any assets are requisitioned or surveyed is conducted. In the case of the SSA, or money, bullion, jewelry, or other valuable articles, or things, or books of accounts, or documents are seized or requisitioned on the case in any other person. So what does it say? It says that in case of these 4 situations, 3 are pertaining to search, 1 is survey. There, the reopening is automatic. There need not be any information in possession of the assessing authority which would suggest that some income has escaped assessment. That condition is done away with insofar as these 4 situations are concerned. And straightway, 3 years prior to the assessment year in which such action takes place would be reopened. However, kindly mark, insofar as search are concerned, search namely first person search and there is third party search, there is no requirement of 148 capital A process. Whereas in case of survey, you have to come out with the information for earlier 3 years, issue draft reasons, call for comments, pass the final order. If final order is against the SSC, then only the assessing authority can assume jurisdiction insofar as survey cases are concerned. Therefore, there is no automatic reopening insofar as survey is concerned. However, there need not be any information in possession of the assessing officer insofar as survey cases are concerned. He can straightway initiate 148A proceedings. Posers, I have probably covered this process. Posers, only the last poser is important. One is, can reopening and consequential assessment pursuant to search be restricted to search material? Look, now what is happening is, as against earlier, I indicated that there are 2 separate processes. One was a regular reopening, another was 153A process. Now both this is combined. Now we have only one 148 proceedings where the search related assessment automatically would take place, as well as a normal assessment, normal reassessment also can take place. Therefore, the question of the line of demarcation, namely the search related assessments being restricted to the material found during the course of the search, is now done away with. And therefore, 148, which is common for both search as well as normal 148, now can that assessment be restricted only to the search material? Kindly also appreciate that under the new system, there is no question of abatement of any pending proceedings as against the old system under 153A. The moment 153A notices are issued, the pending proceedings before the AO would abate. necessarily. And therefore, those proceedings would be covered under 153A assessment. However, there is no such process of abatement under the revised new scheme. And the assessment is also going to be common assessment. And therefore, one cannot argue that this assessment is restricted to the search material alone. However, it is going to be an interesting question, which is again going to be tested before the legal forums. Again, 148 notice, they say that permission of specified authority is required. Time limit is now we have only two time limits. One is if 3 years have elapsed from the end of the relevant assessment year, unless the case falls under B. And if 3 years, but not more than 10 years. So there is a separate category of 3 to 10 years have elapsed from the end of the relevant assessment year, unless the assessing officer has in his possession books of accounts or other documents or evidence which reveal that the income chargeable to tax represented in the form of asset. Now, asset is defined. What does the asset mean? It includes immovable properties, being land or building or both, shares, securities, loans and advances, deposits in the bank account, which has escaped assessment amounts to or likely to amount to 50 lakhs rupees or more for that year. So there is a separate category, 3 to 10 years. And what are the requirements? Assessing officer must have in his possession books of accounts, other documents or evidence. Now, this books of accounts, other documents or evidence, can it be treated as an information within the meaning of 148 or no? Will have to be again tested, because 148 says that reopening can take place, and that 148 is applicable even to this outer larger limit cases also, that there is only two source of information. One, risk management strategy. Two, audit objection. Now, books of accounts or other documents or evidence is not considered as a source of information. Of course, unless CBDT in his risk management strategy comes out that anyone who is searched and his books of accounts or other documents or evidences are part of risk management strategy, and therefore they automatically become information within the meaning of 148. However, for the purpose of understanding this proposition, at this stage, one will have to remember that books of accounts, other documents or evidences must fall within the definition of information so as to assume jurisdiction under 149, because this independent evidences cannot replace the information, because information is again required for the purpose of initiation of 148. Assets, again, assets definition is so wide that any immovable property or land, building, both, or share securities, namely this even penny stock share securities, any loans and advances, namely 68 transactions, or any deposit, Jandhan account, you have converted your black money into white by using somebody else's account. All these transactions would be covered, and the sum of 50 lakhs is a threshold. If it is less than 50, probably you can some relief. So 149, these are all various procedural aspects. We can skip them. Asset definition we have already covered. Issue is necessarily mean that it has to be handed over to someone, and that definition is the same. Issued, the language under 149 is the same as appearing in the existing provisions, and therefore the interpretation also would be the same. This chart we have already covered. 151, there are two authorities which are contemplated, so we can skip that. This would take me to the next part of the presentation, and that is validity of the notice is issued under 148 after 31st March under the old scheme. What is the issue? Issue is that now we have already analyzed the scheme. We know, we are familiar with the new scheme with effect from 1/4/2021. We also know for fact that there is a material diversion. There is a significant difference between the old scheme and the new scheme. New scheme has it has a paradigm shift on insofar as the reopening process is concerned. And therefore, one cannot argue that both are the same scheme, only the old scheme with new clothes or old wine in the new bottle. No, it is an altogether different poison. And therefore, the question is that when the new act has already been introduced into the statute book, can the lawmakers, mind you, here the lawmakers are the executives exercising power under section 119 or under the Taxes and Other Amendment Act 2020, can they, in the guise of issuing a notification, extend the life and applicability of the old act? Look, what the notifications did, there are two notifications, notification 20 and notification 38. What they did was, they say that for the purpose of issuance of notice under 148, the time limit specified under 149, sanctioned under 151, is now extended from 31st March initially to 30th of April and thereafter to 30th of June. Therefore, this has resulted into a very incongruent situation. What has happened is, we have one law, namely the new law, which is duly made, enacted by the parliament by following due process of law, which is still holding the field with effect from 1st April 2021. Simultaneously, the old law, which would otherwise have ceased to have any effect with effect from 31st March 2021, somehow got an extension. It got extended life. And that life is now conflicting with the revised or the amended act. So for a limited period, we have a situation where we have old act duly extended by the executives, exercising power under 119, again granted by the parliament. And we have the new act, which is duly enacted by the parliament, again holding the field. And therefore, the situation would be that both the provisions exist simultaneously. They are both operating and holding the same field. And therefore, the question would arise as regards, how do we interpret both these provisions simultaneously? Can there be a situation under the Income Tax Act where two provisions operate simultaneously? The answer is empathetic no. We can't have two provisions operate simultaneously. And therefore, ultimately, one provision has to give way to the another provision. And how today can we decide which provision is correct and which provision is not so correct? Prima facie, it appears that the extension was done by the executives in exercise of the delegated power. So it was nothing but an exercise under the delegated legislative powers. Now, Parliament under Section 119 has given a very limited power to the executives, namely CBDT and officers operating under CBDT, to come out with circulars, to come out with notifications, so as to make the life of taxpayers easy. In order to implement the law effectively for administrative purposes, this power is given. Now, that power cannot be used so as to come out with the extension of life of a particular section which has expired, and such power cannot be used so as to supersede or override the law which is duly made and declared by the parliament. So in the guise of legislative power, delegated legislative power, can the executives override and overreach the law which is enacted by the parliament? Answer appears to be no. We have judgments to that effect, that the power of the executives is always subservient to the power of the parliament to enact law. And therefore, parliament is supreme. Whenever there is a situation where the law of the parliament is pitted against the law which is declared by the executives, the supremacy is obviously that of the parliament's law. Today also, we do not have any ordinance, any mechanism whereby the law which is duly enacted by the parliament, effect from 1/4/2021, has been suspended, or the operation thereof has been stayed for first quarter, namely 1st April to 30th June 2021. In absence of there being any proviso, any ordinance restricting the power of the new act, the old act duly extended by notifications cannot operate. And therefore, the notifications, ultimately, they have to give way to the law which is declared by the parliament. If that be so, then all these reopening notices issued after 1/4/2021 will have to then pass the test of the amended scheme of the act. Now, they would not pass the amended schemes test for the simple reason that these are the cases where reasons are recorded first, reopening notices are issued thereafter. As against that, we have a process of 148A where the draft notices are issued and final order is passed under 148A. And thereafter, the reopening can take place. Second requirement is 149 prescribes two time limit, 3 years and 10 years. The reopenings which are within the period of 3 years probably can sail through, but the reopenings which are beyond 3 years and within the period of 10 years, they'll have to pass one more test of clause B under 149, wherein that document, etc., the proof thereof, and the asset in excess of 50 lakhs test is also required to be not only passed, but it has to be demonstrated in the reasons recorded so as to assume jurisdiction. So all these issues would arise, and a large number of SSCs have challenged these reopening notices, which are completely according to them without jurisdiction. There are Delhi, Bombay, and Calcutta. All high courts have entertained such petitions, issued notices, and in appropriate cases, granted the ad interim relief in terms of stay of notices issued under 148. In Gujarat also, we have filed a large number of such petitions, but however, none of the matters have yet been fixed up for hearing so far, and therefore we do not know the view of the Gujarat High Court at this stage. But then this is going to be an interesting litigation, and it will go right up to the Supreme Court so as to decide whether the extension is valid or no, and which law will operate and prevail over which law. Friends, with this, I'm through with my presentation. In case of any questions, I'll be.
But there are a few questions in the chat box. If it's convenient, or if you wish, we can go to the questions so that you can answer.
I think let us read it so that it is easy for him to answer.
Yes, yes. Okay. Someone can read, I'll answer. Yes.
Okay, sir. I'll read a question for you. There's a question from Shailesh Kumar Patel. He says, a notice issued under section 153C for assessment year 2010-11 during assessment year 22-23. He is asking for your advice on validity of it.
So your voice is not on.
Tushar sir, are you there?
Sir, we are not able to. Okay.
No, my voice is, I'm waiting for the question to be finished.
Okay, sorry. No, so that was the question.
That was the question.
What was the question? I'm sorry.
Question I will repeat. The notice issued under section 153C for the assessment year 2010-11.
Yes.
But the notice is issued during assessment year 22-23.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So he wants to know your advice upon validity of the said notice.
That notice apparently is time barred because it is issued beyond a period of 10 years also, the outer limit which is available. Even if during the search, if some asset is found out. One can raise, because 153C also, the process is to raise the objection before the authorities. You raise the objection before the authorities and, you know, thereafter, depending upon the result that you receive, we can decide whether to challenge that or not.
The second question, sir, notice has been issued on 30th March 2021 for assessment year 2013-14. Notice is for reopening assessment under section 147. He wants to know your views on the provisions with section 149(1)(b).
It's apparently time barred. However, if we take into consideration the notifications, then probably one can argue that it is within the time. Again, the advice is that if it is issued on 31st March, and if you believe that 6 years, because assessment year involved is 13-14, and 13-14, if we add 6 years, then it is 31st March 2020. Now, if 31st March 2020, the notice is not issued, then probably one can argue that this is a time-barred notice. However, after before 30th of March 2020, there were a series of orders whereby the time limit was extended from time to time. And my recollection is that the time limit is extended right up to 30th of June 2021. And therefore, to that extent, probably again, he'll have to challenge the validity of those notifications and find out whether the notice which is issued on 31st March 21 is barred by limitation or no. Probably, my answer is that probably it may look that this notice is issued within time.
This next question from Amit Kumar Prajapati, who says that notice under section 148 received via email on 1st of April 2021, early in the morning. However, the notice has been dated to 31st March 21, digitally signed by an officer at 8 p.m. on 31st March. E-proceeding option was not open on 1st 4.21. We have taken the screenshot of the same. The option for e-proceeding tab opened on 2nd April. So can he challenge the notice?
Yes, he can. It is a time-barred notice because the law says that it has to be served before 31st of March. And if he has received it on 1st April, then it is obviously time-barred. And if in the email, the law is that email has to be sent before 31st March, 12 o'clock in the night. So email, it is instantaneous. It is not that you send the email and then after 1 hour it gets delivered. Many a times the server takes time. I do not know how the income tax department server functions. They might show that we have shoot the email at 11:59 on 31st March and you might have received it 1 or 2 hours late. But then if at all it can be demonstrated that yes, I have received it on 1st April night, then probably one can challenge that on the presumption that it is also sent late. If department somehow can establish that it is sent before 12 o'clock in the night, 31st March, then probably they are right because the law says that notice has to be issued. It does not say it has to be served. And the definition of issue is that it must leave the physical possession of the issuing authority before the time limit prescribed. So once they say that, yes, I sent the email before 12 o'clock in the night, it was beyond his control. And if that is the law, then he can be right. So therefore, you will have to take chances and challenge this particular aspect.
So there is a similar question to this, that notice under section 148 issued on 30th June 2021 for assessment year 2018-19. However, the notice has been received by the assessor on 3rd of July 21.
So you can challenge it on both the counts. First is the validity of the notification itself can be challenged because this extended period is available only because of the notifications. And therefore, those notifications can be challenged, as also the fact that it is beyond a period of 3 years under the revised law. And therefore, it is not permissible. However, if the view is taken that the old law was existing even up to 30th of June, then also he can argue that that 30th June notice was delivered much after that. So he'll have it both ways. He can challenge it both ways.
So one is another question, that notice for assessment year 2016-17 manually signed by ITO having stamp of 2nd July 21, also showing this date on speed post track record sent by department on 2nd July 21 and received by assessee on 6th of July 21. Later the notice got uploaded on the portal on 16th July 21 as well as received through email also on same date 16th July 21. So he wants to know your kind opinion about validity of the said notice.
Illegal. The same answer. Both the counts. Because 30th June, assuming that this extension is valid, then also time available was up to 30th June. So first challenge is that this extension itself is illegal. Second is, assuming that it is valid up to 30th of June, he has received it after that date. And in fact, the AO signed it on 2nd of July, apparently. Or posted it on 2nd of July. So therefore, it is either ways, it is illegal.
That's the question we have till now. If any other member have any other questions, sir is with us.
There was this last question. Have you dealt with it? Nishal Bhai Shah's question.
Sir, that was said that 148 notice on 30th June. Same. Sir has
okay.
answered that.
Okay.
Sir, there's another question that does argument of mechanical approval at clause A, B, D of section 148A and 148 are available under new regime?
Mechanical approval, yes, argument is available because whenever there is a provision which says that with the prior approval of the higher authority, it is not an empty formality. The courts have already taken a view that whenever approval is contemplated, that approval has to be after application of mine. It cannot be that you put any paper before the higher authority and they sign it without reading anything. So 151 approval is always available. The moment you can demonstrate that the authorities have acted mechanically and without application of mine, one can always argue that point, even under the amended new laws.
So this S.V. Agrawal, sir, is raising hand. I guess he wants to ask some question. If we can unmute him.
I requested him to unmute, but he's still not unmuted. Agrawal sir, if you can
unmute yourself and ask the question.
Hello.
Yes, you are audible, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Sir, you are audible.
Go ahead with your question.
Sir, the question is, in the new provision, there is a requirement of taking objection. In the old provision, there was requirement to taking objection at the time of receipt of the reasons recorded. So under the new provision, AO has to record reasons for two times, that first is provisionally and second is finally. So objection is to be raised after receipt of the provisional reasons or not?
Sir, there is nothing like provisional reasons under the new act. It is only for the purpose of understanding that we might call it provisional reasons. The first part is 148A, you can take it as a show cause notice. So that is first part is a show cause notice where you are given an opportunity based on the information and material available with the assessing authority. He might ask you that, sir, this is the information. This is my inference on that information. This is how I believe that income has escaped assessment. What have you to say on this? This is the stage where we'll have to file our response. Once we file the response, that response would be taken into consideration. And AO under 148A(d) clause 4, he'll pass an order dealing with these objections. That order would be treated as reasons recorded. And that is the order which would be used for the purpose of issuing notice under 148.
Thereafter, sir, against 148A, you cannot take any objection.
No, that objection stage is over. Thereafter, 148 notice will be issued, and if you are agreed with 148 notice, you go straight away before the High Court.
Achha, so before High Court only, after 148A order will be gone or against so-called notice?
148A notice will have to be necessarily followed by 148. Look, 148A is a precursor to 148. 148A proceedings will happen before notice under 148 is issued. Once that 148A order is passed, an authority reaches to the conclusion that yes, we have material suggests that there is some escapement of income and therefore we want to reopen this particular assessment year. Notice for that particular assessment year would be issued thereafter. And along with the notice, you will be also be given an order under 148A. That to be taken, that order will have to be taken as reasons recorded. If you are agreed with that notice and reasons recorded, you can straightway approach the High Court.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
So there's another question with reference to time barring notices. The participants wants to know whether he should challenge the time barring notice with AO or he should approach High Court.
Time barring notices are, we are talking about the notices which are issued after 1st April before 30th of June. Those time barring notices.
Or even after few notices which are received after 30th June.
No. Look, if there are two different processes, if the notices are without jurisdiction, namely the 148 notices for this period, 1st April to 30th of June, they have been issued based on the notification. There is a serious challenge as regards the constitutional validity of these notifications. And if we are right in our say that these notifications are ultra vires the constitution, then there is no question of issuing any consequential notices. In such a circumstances, you can straightway, even without having to file any return of income, you can straightway approach the High Court and challenge the notifications. And as a consequence, also challenge the reopening notice. Because if notifications are illegal, obviously the notice will also be held to be illegal. That is first part. If you believe that, no, mine is otherwise regular assessment. However, there is a case where post office rubber stamp is of a later date, or email is received after the date, which is the limitation period. Under such a circumstances, these are all, you are entering into the arena of the facts as regards the service of notice. Then you have to raise these objections before the AO that, sir, your service rubber stamp is of 2nd July or your email is received at 1 o'clock in the night on 1st April. All those factual aspects will have to be raised before the authority. Let them investigate, let them rebut your factual assertions, and then you can approach the High Court. Because for the first time, if you take this objection, how would High Court know whether it is received in your inbox at 1 o'clock or post office has put a rubber stamp of 1st April, 2nd July? We do not know. So if at all it is into that area, then you raise objections before the authority and you approach High Court thereafter.
This question from Anand Modi. He says he has received 148 notice after March 21 with the approval of joint commissioner. So he wants to know that is sufficient compliance or the approval of compliance, approval of commissioner is required.
Commissioner approval has come into the statute book with effect from 1st April 2021. So therefore, this notice apparently is passed under the old act. So old act, if we want to challenge, you have to challenge it by challenging the notifications under the old act. And therefore, that is the remedy. Because new act itself is not made applicable. These are all the notices issued under the old extended act. And under the old extended act, even joint commissioner approval was valid.
I think Nirav bhai, if required, take one more question if required, then let's, because sir has been speaking continuously for 120 minutes now. We need to appreciate that, appreciate the same as well.
Thank you, but then lawyers are used to, you know, talk non-stop for 5 hours a day. So
especially with the High Court's is working this
day. I know. Fine. Then
thank you, Tushar sir, for your valuable time and accepting our invitation and sharing your expertise and knowledge with the members at large. I'm sure with your expertise and your knowledge and lecture delivered today, have enriched the members at large. So we had more than 86 participants here at Zoom platform and 10 odd numbers at YouTube watching this channel. If we have Niket bhai online, can I request him to propose an official heartiest vote of thanks to Tushar sir? Niket bhai, if you are there.
Niket bhai, you are mute. Niket bhai, you are mute.
Niket bhai, you are mute. Please unmute yourself first. Niket bhai.
Okay. I am very thankful to Monish bhai and Nirav bhai for giving me this opportunity, and I am very grateful to association and committee also for arranging such a wonderful session, and I am also very thankful to Tushar sir for such a very great session. And as we all know that nowadays there are two provisions, new and old regime are there in the provision, and we all are required to have a very thorough knowledge of both these provisions. And thank you to Tushar sir that sir has explained in very good manner, and he gave us a very crystal clear idea about both old as well as new provisions and both those differences also. So once again, thank you very much Tushar sir, and I am also thankful to our participants also that they made this meeting possible. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tushar sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Tushar sir. And Tushar sir, the appreciation from the Chartered Accountants Association with regards to the lecture that you have delivered today
We will be sending you a memento. Physically, it is not possible to meet, and I would have loved to have a discussion in physical mode sometime later, but for sure. And please do accept it on behalf of the Chartered Accountant Association.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.